For those people searching for the light of Christ in Fort Worth, Texas, St. Patrick's Cathedral offers members of the Catholic community a place to worship.
Well, St. Patrick's anchors the Diocese of Fort Worth in its service as the cathedral. A cathedral is not just a large Catholic church. A cathedral has a particular function in our understanding of what it means to be the Catholic Church, in that it is the parish church of the bishop. In other words, the bishop is the pastor of the cathedral, technically. And the word cathedral comes from the Latin word cathedra, which means chair, not just any chair, but a chair that is the sign of the teaching authority of the bishop.
As the spiritual center of the Diocese of Fort Worth, St. Patrick's wasn't always a cathedral. Prior to 1969, it was part of the western portion of the Diocese of Dallas. But to discover how the history of the Diocese of Fort Worth started, one has to travel back to the early 1500s. The early church in Texas started with the arrival of Spanish missionaries. In Texas, the earliest missions were around San Antonio, San Angelo, Presidio, Nacogdoches, and El Paso. The first Catholic diocese in Texas was the Diocese of Galveston and was established in 1847. The Diocese of Galveston encompassed 360,000 square miles and included all of Texas as well as parts of what is now New Mexico, Oklahoma, Wyoming, and parts of Colorado.
In 1840, Jean-Marie Audin from France came to Texas. He had come to America in 1822, became a Vincentian priest, worked up in that area of Prevou, Missouri for many years, and then in 1840 was sent to Texas. And there he arrived at Galveston. And he stayed there for quite a while. He built the Diocese of Galveston, literally. And then in 1847, he was named Bishop of Galveston. Pope Pius IX established the Diocese of Galveston, and he was named the bishop. And he stayed here until 1861, the beginning of the Civil War.
Father Odin sent missionary priests on horseback from Galveston through Fort Worth. The visiting priests would say Mass in private homes, the courthouse, and available halls. In 1862, Bishop Claude Marie Dubuis succeeded Bishop Odin, and in 1870, Father Mathurin J. Perrier began visiting Fort Worth to celebrate Mass and administer the sacraments. In 1875, Father Perrier increased his visits to Fort Worth to once a month. Between the years 1866 and 1876, the population of Fort Worth grew to 2,000. The coming of the railroads in 1876 helped increase the population further. Many of the railroad workers were Irish Catholics. In July 1876, Bishop Dubuis assigned Thomas Lockery to Fort Worth as its first resident priest. 3 months later, the first Catholic church was built and named in honor of St. Stanislaus Koska. Father Lockery was replaced in 1884 by Father Jean-Marie Gaillot, who is credited with conceiving St. Patrick's, built on the grounds next to St. Stanislaus. On October 14, 1888, the cornerstone was laid and blessed by the new Bishop of Galveston, Bishop Nicholas A. Gallagher. The parishioners of St. Stanislaus were Irish by majority and voted to name the new church St. Patrick's. On July 10, 1892, the first bishop of the new Diocese of Dallas, Bishop Thomas Brennan, dedicated the new St. Patrick Church. In 1885, the Sisters of St. Mary of Namur arrived to establish Catholic education in Fort Worth. By 1889, they had built St. Ignatius Academy.
After a number of years, the Bishop of Galveston, who by that time was Bishop Gallagher, asked them to go to Fort Worth to establish a school. At that time, there was a series of forts that had been built to protect the settlers from Indian raids. And of course, Fort Worth was one of the most important of these. So the sisters came to Fort Worth and they found that there were very, very few Catholic families in the town, which at that time had about 6,000 as a population.
At first, the sisters had to make do with what space they could find while their new school was being built.
They established themselves in a house which was called the Roche House, R-O-C-H-E, because that was the name of the man who had owned it. And they established the school and their convent in that house. And for the first 4 years, this was 1885 now, they had to curtain off a part of the church every morning after Mass, and they taught some of the classes there. The sisters then decided that because they were having so many pupils come from the outlying areas of Texas, that they needed to build a proper school also. And so they began the building, which we now know as St. Ignatius Academy, which is still exists on the property south of the cathedral. This school then opened and was advertised throughout north central Texas. And because of the demand, the sisters took boarders. So there were many girls who came from ranches and from very small towns where they had no opportunity for a Catholic education, sometimes not even for a high school education. And so the area developed and the number of pupils increased, and even St. Ignatius was much too small.
At the turn of the century, there were other accomplishments in the Fort Worth Catholic community. The Sisters of Namur established the Our Lady of Victory College and Academy in 1910, the first Catholic college in Fort Worth, south of the city on Hemp Hill Street. Under Bishop Joseph Dunn, the second bishop of the Diocese of Dallas, the Catholic population continued to grow. And to accommodate that growth, a number of parishes were established in Fort Worth, All Saints in 1902, Holy Name in 1907, St. Mary of the Assumption in 1908, and in 1909, St. Rita's, a former mission in Handley, Texas, became a parish in East Fort Worth. There were 26 parishes at that time in the area we now know as the Diocese of Fort Worth. The third bishop of the Diocese of Dallas was Bishop Joseph Lynch. By 1952, the diocese had grown to 53 parishes, and Thomas K. Corman was named coadjutor bishop of Dallas. He was designated to assist Bishop Lynch in the administration of the diocese. When Bishop Lynch retired in 1954, Bishop Gorman noted the growth of Fort Worth and renamed the diocese as the Dallas-Fort Worth Diocese, with St. Patrick Church elevated to co-cathedral status. Bishop Gorman asked Pope Paul VI to split the Diocese of Dallas into the Diocese of Fort Worth and the Diocese of Dallas. Pope Paul accepted the recommendation, and on August 9, 1969, he created the Diocese of Fort Worth that encompassed 23,950 square miles and 28 North Texas counties, from Hill County to the south to Cook County on the north and Hardman County to the northwest. At that time, the Fort Worth Diocese had 53 diocesan priests and 33 religious priests. As one of the oldest buildings still standing in Fort Worth, St. Patrick's architecture is Gothic Revival. It's one of the earliest Gothic Revival churches in North Texas. It was constructed about 10 years earlier than the Catholic Cathedral in Dallas.
For the United States, it is a distinctive kind of Gothic Revival because it doesn't follow the sort of English model of a very romantic sort of a building with lots of different heights and interest in it. It's French. You would not know it looking at it. It doesn't look like French, but it probably the great model for Catholic Church architecture was Renwick St. Patrick's in New York, which did not follow an English model, but would follow the French kind of a model, which was completed in dedicated 1878, I think, just in time for it to be an influence all over the United States.
Father Gayo and James J. Kane, the architect of St. Patrick's, modeled the church after the churches Father Gayo grew up attending in his native France.
And so the architect had this interesting, inventive solution. He started out laying the foundation in fitted stones. It's a technique that comes from Europe. I've seen walls in Europe that you really couldn't get a penknife blade between them. But the thing about them is that they give some, see. And so he had enough prescience to know that if you don't give it a little bit room to give, what it's going to do is break up. So if you excavate by the side of it, you'll see that it starts in a very loose kind of way, and as you get up further, it gets tighter and tighter, and by the time you're a foot below ground, it just looks like a stone wall with cement in it.
Mr. Raymond O'Connor helped successfully restore the outside of the cathedral in the early 2000s. Prior to the restoration work, he noted the soil around and under the cathedral.
There's a stratum just below the soil here in the downtown that's pretty stable, and I suspect most of that foundation's actually just sitting on that. It was made pretty clear that that limestone was quarried around here, probably out west somewhere. It's a good stone, but it's high in clay content, and that clay was one of the culprits of causing the stuff to come apart on the first few inches of thickness, the part exposed to the elements. When we got involved in it, there had been years worth of research done on the limestone because it was visibly coming apart and very dark and dirty and soiled and all the stuff that goes with a building of that age that had some issues. And kind of ferreting out what the best course of action was for that landmark was really a challenge. So that's probably something people don't often know, is that you can quarry things like that local to where the building went up. You know, in ancient history that was true because there wasn't a choice, but in modern times almost everything comes from somewhere else, you know. Overseas or up north or some limestones here in Texas.
Inside the church, you will find two types of pews.
One of the other things that occurred to me, and I've had a chance to look at it again, is how interesting the pews are, because the pews in the center were made and installed with the church in 1889-90. The ones in the side aisles are from the old St. Stanislaus and were cut down to do the side aisles. And they're a different style, you know, which is just wonderful to know that they're there.
In 1910 and 1911, of course, the church needed money, depression times, and one way that they were going to raise money was to rent the pews. And you could see numbers on the pews, the theory being if because there were so many masses at St. Patrick, there weren't other Catholic churches. You could rent, the first pew for the 8 o'clock Sunday Mass. That was your spot, and so nobody else could be there.
St. Patrick's long history includes pastors acquiring many works of religious artwork, statuary, and stained glass. Monsignor O'Donohoe was the rector of St. Patrick's during the years 1940 to 1956. He added a great number of artworks, statues, and other religious artifacts to St. Patrick's. Kay Fialho, the archivist and historian for St. Patrick's Cathedral, offers tours of the facility and its many artworks.
As you come in the front doors, which, by the way, were cut down by Monsignor New in 2001 when the church had what you might call a renovation, and the original doors, or the doors at that time, opened in, which was not good in fire control. And so they cut them down and pushed them out, even though we were grandfathered and could have left it that way. I talk about the Sorrowful Mother altar and the Crucifixion altar, both of which were installed by Monsignor O'Donohue. The De Prato Studios in Chicago made them, even the statue itself of the Blessed Mother. She has seven little buds going around her head at the back of the altar. Those represent the seven sorrows of the Blessed Mother, Above her head, at the very top, were three roses, representing Mary as a daughter of God the Father, the bride of the Holy Spirit, and the mother of Christ, God. Below on that altar, you'll see a heart pierced by seven swords. Again, that represents the seven sorrows of the Blessed Virgin. To the left, as you're looking at the altar, is a statue of Saint Maria Goretti. To the right is a statue of Saint Francis of Assisi. That statue and then the one of the Blessed Mother down at the center were all done in the Spanish polychrome method of wood carving. It takes about 2 years to carve them. They're made of Mexican cedar wood. Over the cedar wood is placed something like plaster of Paris. Over that is painted 24 karat gold leaf. Then the artist will paint over the gold leaf. The design is kind of a dark green color, and then he'll go back and over the dark green color, they might scrape it to show gold threads coming through. St. Francis of Assisi is an exact replica of a statue of St. Francis that is in Mexico in the Museum of the Viceroyalty. We have the crucifixion altar, the corpus of Christ on that altar. Monsignor got that in Mexico. At that time, he said it was 500 years old. On the left of that altar is a statue of St. Anthony of Padua, a very beautiful one. And again, that's one of the Spanish polychrome ones. On the right is a statue of St. Roque. St. Roque is known as a patron saint of plagues, great diseases that sweep over the country. And in 1947, our parish prayed to St. Roque that if nobody contracted polio, because of course that was before the salt vaccine, they would get a statue in his honor. And no one in the parish did. They got the statue. And then as you go down the aisle, you look back up at the rose window. Rose window is the American School of Stained Glass. And at the very bottom of it, it says dedicated January 1892 by Right Reverend Edward Fitzgerald. At that time, Right Reverend meant bishop. So he was a bishop of Arkansas, of Little Rock. And when Bishop Brennan left the Dallas Diocese in 1890, they needed someone until the Holy Father of Vatican appointed a new bishop. And so Fitzgerald came down and was in Dallas. And then the windows, I do know and have correspondence from Monsignor O'Donohue, where he's removing a window. He said, we all know that stained glass doesn't last more than 65 years, and that the windows had become damaged by carbon monoxide, and that some of the donors of the original windows, their families were not around anymore to update these windows. So he was in the process, I think, of replacing every single window we had. Then between probably 47 to his death, he would take a window out, send it to Emil Fry, or have them make a new one of somebody totally different. In the process, he has a window dedicated to his mother, one to Monsignor DeFalco's mother. When you look at the church from the very back, meaning the entrance, you'll see the crucifixion window with the two columns and then the statue of the Virgin of the Apocalypse up on the very top with 12 lights going around her head, which represent the 12 original tribes of Israel. When Father Guillot had the church designed in Gothic Revival, those columns were not there. You could see all of the crucifixion window. Part of it is blocked now by the two columns, and then I think it says Sanctus, Sanctus, Sanctus across the top and then leading on up to the Blessed Mother. That again is Baroque features that Monsignor O'Donohue had the De Prato Studios build. So as we go down, you'll see, and it's marble and faux marble. All of these altars are done in what's known as a scagliola, which is making, it's fake, it's making plaster look like marble, and it dates back to times of the Medicis. As you approach the communion rail, which was originally wooden, it has some marble on the top, but the rest of it is the full marble. And he replaced the communion rail. Then we go over to the Blessed Virgin's altar. The central statue is the third one that was done in the Spanish polychrome. On her right is a statue of Saint Jude. The statue on the right of her is Our Lady of Guadalupe. It's the only statue, as far as I can tell, in that church that was not acquired by Monsignor O'Donohue. And then, of course, after Vatican II, you had to build an altar facing the people. We were most fortunate that somebody didn't come in and yank our back altar, what we call the altar of repose right now, or high altar, out, because that happened in many, many churches. But for some reason, they left ours alone. And we had an original, it would be original, wooden altar put in after Vatican II. And then you move over to the St. Joseph's altar. Standing in front of it is the baptismal font. The baptismal font is given in memory of Clara Wiley Jewell. They gave it as a gift to the church. Then you look up and see St. Joseph. And below him on the bottom of that altar are the carpenter's tools, signifying it's St. Joseph. On the left of that is a statue of Mother Cabrini. And on the right is a statue of St. Francis of Paula. He, in his life, sought to imitate St. Francis of Assisi. And he advocated not eating anything, milk, cheese, animal, at all. Pretty much lived on vegetables. And he lived to be 95, 96. Then as you go up toward the altar, you'll see a statue of the Sacred Heart of Jesus. Then you will see a statue of St. Patrick. And then you come to the main altar, and then the sacristy door, and above that is a statue of the little flower, St. Therese. Monsignor Nolan is the one who purchased the Stations of the Cross on a trip to Europe. They were from Ortizzi, Italy. Very beautiful. The wood carver was Hans Schmalzel. Apparently a lot of wood carving happened in Ortizzi. And I believe that they arrived in 1927. The new sacristy was added, and the windows were done by the Smith brothers. And they're nice windows, and certainly depict saints. And I should mention, when they enlarge the sacristy, that you'll see a bas-relief of St. Patrick on the outside of the building. That was done by the Smith Studios, too. Now we go into the chapel. Monsignor O'Donohue, he was the one who refined it. He built the chapel, and it was to be built for priests to be buried, called the Poor Souls or the All Souls Chapel. Once it was built, then he went to Oakwood Cemetery. Father Guillot had been buried there in 1907. Now it was 1947, 40 years later. So he asked Guy Thompson, the mortician, to go over to Calvary and disinter Father Guillot. They pulled up Father Guillot's remains and opened the coffin, and he was fully clothed as a priest, but even a guy said little boots to wear in the muddy streets of Fort Worth. He folded him over and put him in the box and put it in. It's the only one that in the basement that has a huge marker on it that says Reverend Jean Marie Guillot. The next person that they show being buried was Father Van. He died in 1953. He had been an assistant at St. Patrick, and when he died, Monsignor O'Donohue wanted him buried down there and kept the permit, because that's what he himself wanted to use when he died. He died 3 years later in 1956, and he's buried down there. There's nobody above Monsignor O'Donohue. There's nobody above Father Van, but in the middle there are two marble covered, obviously occupied by somebody. And Latin words do not tell you who it is. They don't. So I was very puzzled as to who those two were. And I asked Guy, he said, I think he brought his parents, his mother's remains and his brother's remains over. And I said, then the two brothers would be in the wall. One of the interesting stories about the chapel and priests being buried down there is Monsignor O'Donohue wanted permission. Well, needed permission from the city. So Guy went to the city fathers, and he said, because a Catholic church has relics, and because relics are bones or parts of bodies, then we already have bodies there. And the city council said, okay. And I asked Guy where the mother was buried. But I found a corner, which is actually behind the altar in the floor that says Ossa Humilita, which is mean humble bones. When Father Hoover came back from a sabbatical in Rome, he wanted to simplify the basement chapel. It was rather ornate when Monsignor O'Donoghue had it. He wanted a limestone altar because the altar that was down there was part of one of the original side altars of the church, the Gothic ones. That was there with a statue of the recumbent Christ on top of it, and that's much too large for the chapel. So right now, that altar is over in the rectory for their chapel.
St. Patrick's is the cathedral for all Catholics in North Texas, as well as the public face of the Catholic Church in Tarrant County, not just symbolically, but also in the ministry. It's the site of weddings, religious education, outreach to the poor and homeless, and of course, Sunday Mass.
St. Patrick's is very important because it has a very rich history. It's a history that begins before the establishment of the Diocese of Fort Worth in 1969. It's a rich history that begins even before the establishment of the Diocese of Dallas in 1890. It's a history that begins with the arrival of the white settlers in the middle 19th century, as well as building on the heritage of the missionaries that came before, hundreds of years ago, to the Texas Plains. And like St. Paul says, where sin abounds, grace abounds all the more, that is especially where the church needs to be for the sake of conversion and service to those who are so in need to be rescued by the gospel. That is part of our legacy as a parish as well as the local church in the lived tradition of the gospel that has been entrusted to us for over 2,000 years.
One of the things, or perhaps the thing that's most important about the cathedral in a kind of historical context is that it's a piece of the past which is disappearing rapidly. And the reason the past is important is without the past, there is no future. Without memory, there's nothing to hope for, nothing to cherish. And so if you are a member of the cathedral or if you're even a citizen of Fort Worth, it's a building that needs to be cherished, not just because it says something about the past, but because it says something about the future.
I love St. Patrick's Cathedral very much, and I'm very proud to be its bishop. One of the reasons that I am proud to be its bishop and the overseer of the pastoral and spiritual life of the cathedral community, as well as of the entire diocese, is that St. Patrick's has always been a sign of hope. From its establishment in the 19th century during the immorality of Hell's Half Acre, to its service to the poor throughout time, through its service of tradition in the midst of tumult and change in the life of the church, to now as a sign of the continuation of the gospel in the midst of relativism and at times a hostile environment, St. Patrick's remains not as something static, but is growing by the service to young people in the church and to welcome it to develop and grow as Christ intends.